So here we are. I have nothing prepared, and you probably think I'm kidding, but I don't prepare when I do these things anymore. I suppose I've been preparing all my life for it. I want you to give me some help in knowing how I can best help you, I guess, is. We have some people with running mics somewhere. And I would like to have you tell me a little bit about what's going on with you, what problems you're facing, what if you had it, or you could figure it out, it would really be helpful to you, those sorts of things. Does that make sense? So if we could just spend a few minutes where you communicated to me, you know, why you're here, what's bothering you, what doesn't work, what challenges you have, what if you had it, it would really be helpful, or if you could figure it out, it would really be helpful. And then I'll have a better idea of who you are and how I can best help you. Because I do have a lot of things that I think will be helpful to you. And I'll write down some of these things if I can figure out how to work this thing. So here's somebody over here. Just if somebody has a hand up, give them a mic, and then when I finish with one person, hold up your mic so that I know who has it. So,
this is on. Okay, cool.
It's on.
Hi. Do you want me to stand here or come up or?
You can do it from there.
Okay, cool. Yeah, my name is Adam. I don't generally have a problem approaching people, but what I need to figure out here is where I'm at, and I think it's a place of chaos. And also my life purpose, which I think has to do with healing my wounds and working with music and sharing it in a family context. I didn't manifest the $1,000, and I would like to coach with David, but I was told yesterday I have to heal. But I have an issue with the money because I have to pay another $1,000 to do the healing with Kirk and Donnie. I also have a problem with women. Yesterday I was
going to... Hey, get in line. Yeah. let me clear this one up for you right now. If you're a man, you have problems with women. If you're a woman, you have problems with men. Forget about it. Okay, All right, so you said something about you needed to heal. So, like, are you talking about emotional healing?
I think that's the primary.
Okay, yeah. Emotional healing. So I'm going to write that here.
And David said I could heal in if I understood it correctly, in the twinkling of an eye, and just let go of the pain.
And you said something about finding your purpose or something?
Yes.
Yeah. You know, I have a cartoon from Gary Larson that I found 20 years or more ago, more than 20, probably 30 years ago, and it shows this really dorky guy looking through the couch cushions, you know, like when you look for change under the couch cushions, and he finds this thing that looks sort of like a whoopee cushion with a bunch of stuff sticking out of it, and the caption said, "Edgar finds his purpose." I don't know if that's helpful or not, but... Oh, sick. So emotional healing, finding your purpose, was there, I mean, you said something about feeling insecure. I guess that's when you talk to people or something?
No, I don't.
That's no, you don't issue. You don't do that.
The issue is that I attract women I'm not attracted to, and the ones I'm attracted to, they go away. And I tend to be drawing dysfunctional women. And it happened yesterday, and I finally just quit and said, you know, bye.
All right. I'll put women down here, but I don't know if you're going to get much traction.
It's a serious issue.
Making jokes about this, yeah. But I understand your dilemma. But, you know, the funny thing about that dilemma is that when you don't, when you don't have a woman, you want one. When you have one, then you start saying, what the fuck am I doing? Look, I'm a relatively old, wise person, and I'm just giving you some... You look stunned.
In a way, yes, but it would be nice to have a relationship that works, because I never had one that worked. They're all dysfunctional.
Me neither. I understand. So I'll say something that may be helpful with that, and then again, it may not be. I don't know. We'll see. Hopefully, something I'll do up here will be helpful. Okay, who else? Thank you. That was helpful to me. So who has a mic? You have a mic. Okay, go.
After decades, I finally found myself through David's program online, and it really feels so freeing. So I found my purpose, and I know what I want to do, but I just feel overwhelmed with all the programs out there and trying to make the right choice for me at the right time. Everyone has a great program, but I'm having a difficult time in trying to decide which person is maybe the right person. So my mind is just really swirling around a lot, and as a result, I find that I really get set back in getting into action, and I do believe that the message I do have out of my own pain will help a lot of other people that have struggled in the same situation that I've been in and being set free.
Okay, well, first of all, I'll clear this up really quickly. If you're looking for people to buy stuff from, just buy it from me. I'm the one.
Okay.
But okay. So.
That adds to the equation. That's one more to think about.
Yeah. So you're confused. I'm confused
on the choices. I'm overwhelmed. I don't know if it's confused.
Confused about
maybe
choices.
Maybe it's overwhelmed
confused
by everyone
about
having
choices.
The greatest, and they all do.
Okay. Confused about choices.
Yes.
Thank you. That's a good one. Who else has a mic? And raise your hand also if you want a mic, and then they'll bring you one. And yeah, go ahead.
Good morning. I love your work. Can you hear me?
Point the mic at you. Yeah, like
and
that.
You hear me now.
Yeah.
Good morning. Love your work. Love Holosync.
Thank you.
Wish I used it more. I'm committing to use it more. I'm really curious about you personally, and I'd love to know sort of if you've used your intuition to achieve a lot of your success, which I'm sure you have, but I'd like to know more about that and how you've made certain choices intuitively versus intellectually.
So you said something about intuition,
mm-hmm.
and how I made choices.
I'd love to know more about your experience with your own intuition and how that's led you to where you are.
Okay, that's a good one. If we keep going long enough, you guys will hit on some things I know about. I'm just kidding. I know about everything. Okay, who else? See, these lights out here make you blind. I hear people out there, but okay.
I've been in the field of transformation for a number of years, and over the past 6 years, I've been doing hypnosis for weight loss. And I feel like it's time for me to move on.
Looks like it's working. You look pretty good. Yes.
I feel like I'm kind of floating out there right now, not knowing which direction to go. I do transformational work, and I'm in the middle of it right now.
In which direction to go for what?
I don't know where I want to go with this.
Yeah. What do you do for a living?
Hypnosis.
Hypnosis.
Yes.
Okay. You do hypnosis for a living.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
And I'm not sure that that's still what I want to do. I'm not sure if I still want to do weight loss. I love the transformational part.
Yeah.
So I don't know what's next, how to label that and get myself out there.
Okay. So that's kind of what a couple of other people have said too.
Okay.
Like they don't know how to choose whatever is, you know, their purpose or what are they going to do next or whatever. Okay. Well, this is helpful. Thank you.
Hello.
Ah. Number six, men. Romantic love, what is it? Please.
Well, I have a lot of experience with this. That's it? If you had that figured out, you'd be set, huh?
Yeah. Well, it's part, definitely part of it, but it's definitely when David said, what are you most struggling with? It's romantic love. Never had an authentic, fabulous romantic love. I've been divorced. I've had relationships. And I've been processing.
How many other people have had that same experience? Tell the truth. What's the rest of you don't have relationships? Come on. All right. Yeah. Anything else?
That's the biggest one.
Okay, yeah. Great. So you came to this wealth seminar to solve your thing about, or just to maybe meet a rich guy, or? No? Okay. Who has a mic?
Right here. Bill.
Okay.
Bill, check. I have a question about a self-development thing that I'm working on.
Okay.
Ever since I was 8 years old, I saw the Beatles on Ed Sullivan, and I've wanted to be a musician. It has been the overwhelming dominant factor in my heart and in my mind for my whole life.
Okay.
And I'm starting to realize from coming to this seminar that anything that you know, are you willing to pay the price? Are you willing to go all the way for your dream?
Right.
And it's all I've ever done all my life. And if after 52 years, I don't know how that could not be enough commitment to it to make it work for me, and it hasn't yet. So I'm a little lost in how to get from where I am right now to all the way in, because
okay, so
I can't imagine the separation.
You're saying that you have had tremendous commitment to it,
yeah,
and but you haven't got it yet.
Right.
Okay, so there must be some other ingredient or something that...
Some kind of separation between everything that I'm throwing into it and actually being all the way in.
And have you practiced 8 hours a day and learned about the business side of it and...
Yes.
Okay. All right, well, let's see. So what should I put down here? Okay. I'll put paid the price, but it ain't working. I mean, this is just to remind me what you said. Does that sum it up? Okay. Somebody else?
I have a mic.
Okay.
Overeating.
Overeating? You're overeating?
Mm-hmm.
Are you overeating?
Yes.
Do you have food with you right now?
No.
So, I'll just be a little broader here and put addictions. This is going to be so amazing when I solve all these problems. Within 3 hours, it's going to blow your mind.
Hello. For me, it's to open to receive love and to have a willingness to be of service.
You're not willing to be of service?
No. Not in any way.
I appreciate you for being honest about that. So you said not willing to receive love and not willing to be of service.
Right.
Okay, now I have to think of a way to say that. Yeah, I guess give and receive. I hope that'll... Let's see. I don't know. I don't have enough room to really do this, but... Isn't that how they do it? You know, they have a... Okay.
Something that I just realized actually was brought to my attention by one of my team members from a situation is I'll set an intention and have an intention and be excited to do it, and yet I have something else will sway me off of it. So it's that inability to stay focused on the direction going and have completion with my commitment. Follow through.
Okay, stay focused.
Hello. Oh.
Yeah, whoever
over here.
Has it.
Back.
Where are you? There you are.
Woo-hoo. Time. I always feel like I don't have enough time to do what I need to do. I feel like I overwork.
You're the one. I'm glad Good. To finally meet you. I knew there was somebody that felt like they didn't have enough time, but I wasn't sure who it was. And here I go to Las Vegas, and there you are. So I hope you don't mind if I'm teasing you about these things.
Not at all.
So you feel like you don't have enough time to do everything. Okay.
Enough said?
That's it?
Good.
Okay. I know what to write down for that one. Okay, a few more. You guys are just, you've been waiting to unload this stuff, haven't you?
Last night, had some breakthroughs. How many? And I raised my levels of being able to ask and receive, and I realized it's about me feeling worthy to receive not just financial, more and more financial, and more and more. My last one came up for me that I also receive or be worthy of receiving support emotionally. So that's just where I'm processing right now. So
okay, so feeling worthy, would that?
Yeah.
Anybody else have a problem with that ever? Anybody feeling too worthy?
Hi, I'd like to, what I experience when I go out is that I'm not fully expressing myself.
Not fully expressing yourself?
Yeah, and I'm an artist.
If you were, I'm just curious, if you expressing yourself, what would you do?
Well, I just hold myself back. So I feel,
Are you holding yourself back right now?
I can feel it in my voice, yeah.
Yeah? Well, yeah. If you weren't holding yourself back right now, what would you be doing?
I would be, I don't know, that's what...
Would you be...
not dancing or anything, no.
Dancing around while you...
No. No, I just, when I go out, I'm just more reserved, and I'd like to just be... Like, when I visualized going out, I saw very clearly, being very natural and relaxed.
So you want to be more relaxed and natural and outgoing?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. You want to be more natural. I'm running out of room, so make these next ones good. Not that these aren't good. That doesn't mean be more national. Okay.
I'm Lindsay, and I need to manifest more clients. And I'm a love coach, so you would like me to help you with your problem with women... Or anybody needs help with problems with men.
I don't know if my problems with women are solvable.
They are. I would guarantee it.
You'll guarantee it.
Yeah,
see?
Why not? Okay, we can go on the road together.
So, do you guys know Lindsay? Those of you who are having these problems, huh? Well, she's guaranteeing it.
Yeah, I'll guarantee it.
She's guaranteeing it.
God gave me a gift. I just happened to be able to use it.
And you have no problems with men?
Not anymore.
Do you just avoid them, or?
No. No, no. I had no men.
Okay. Other than getting up to kind of give yourself a pitch.
No, I need to manifest clients.
Oh, you want more clients?
I'm serious.
Okay.
Yeah, that's my issue.
Okay, more clients. Well... Okay, more clients. Or customers or whatever.
Sure, sure.
Okay, let's see. Let's, two more people. Don't any of you guys, except for this guy over here, want to, it's all?
What was the question?
Well, it's all women. You women have a lot of problems.
We're creators.
Bill, would you speak to me about dignity, please?
Dignity?
Yes.
Okay.
That's what's really come up for me. I had an icky experience, and I felt like I was being slimed. Last night I had a great experience. I didn't get any slime. But because I didn't want to go back to the slime, you know, I would ask people for money, and nobody gave me any, but it felt really good. But now I'm afraid to put myself back out there again because I don't want to lose my dignity because I feel I finally got it back.
So you felt it was undignified to ask for money?
Yes, I believe I probably do feel that way. And the first dollar I got, it felt like $1 million. Then I got a $100 bill and felt like crap. And then I had like an icky night and I'm trying to figure out what in the world's going on. I figured I was receiving all this flirtatious energy that I didn't want, and I didn't know what to do with it, and I couldn't figure out what was incongruent.
Give it to her.
And last night,
see, everything is fine. It's just some of you are getting what the other people wanted, and you know. So you were out there groveling for money, and you felt undignified. And a lot of guys were flirting with you.
Yeah.
And
not the guys I wanted to have flirt with.
Yeah,
me,
isn't it that the way it works? Somebody else said that too. The ones you did over here, that the ones that you like, they go away, and the ones you don't like are all over you. What a world, huh? Okay, so I'm not sure. So what is your question about dignity?
Well, I guess I'm afraid to lose it. So I guess the only way I could lose it is to not be me or not be genuine. Uh-huh. And I what I felt like this morning is what I give, I want to give. Well, because I went around complimenting people and taking lots of pictures, and I just wanted to offer myself to do what I look like I could do for free, I guess. And I just didn't want to. I guess I just didn't want to ask. Well, if I did something nice for somebody, I didn't want to then turn it into a, now what will you do for me? And so I just approached people cold, and I presented them once I finally got the words figured out, and I didn't receive any money. And I guess I'm afraid that because I felt good about not receiving any of the money, I don't want to go back home and still not receive money.
Your life sounds complicated, that's for sure.
Well, I guess that's one of my problems. I do like to complicate things.
Well, you've done a fantastic job in this case.
I really have.
But you know, I have to say you've done it in a very dignified way.
Yeah, that totally sums it up. When I was a kid, I chose to believe that I would have to learn how to live without money and without love. And that I would only have to have God. And I don't want
to
go home.
You'd only have to have what?
Pardon me?
You'd only have to have?
That I'd have to learn how to live with only God. Without money and without love.
Without money, without love, just God.
So that's like hugely complicated.
So are you a nun?
My dad sure would have loved for me to have been, but I didn't want to be because I just wanted to fall in love, get married, have kids, have a wonderful family. That was my dream.
And have a lot of money?
Yeah.
But you decided okay, I get it. All right, one more person. Okay.
I'm just writing.
Oh, it's
that
a person
down.
with a Y chromosome too. Good.
Yeah, I appreciate you calling a man out, and that's so the word that I first heard was ego.
Okay.
To put down. It's clear that my life purpose has been coming through this week, as it's been coming through my life, is to work with men.
You work with men?
Yes.
Okay.
So I appreciate your playful nature and your power as man. And it's, yes, I love it. So ego, that just was the first word that when you said, what, are there no men who are going to stand up? And I just...
You think the men aren't standing up because they don't want to reveal that they have a problem?
I have no idea why the others aren't standing up.
Okay, so what? So is that why you weren't standing up, or is that?
That's what the first thought was that came to mind. Just ego.
Okay, that it's a little too vulnerable or something.
Or just how do you engage with the ego? How do you let it be there? How do you, you know, anything about the ego?
Okay, all right. Ego.
Thank you.
All right. Okay, so. When you look at that, are these representative of your problems? No? No, somebody has. So how many people have problems financially? You're not making enough money or whatever, okay? And how many people have romantic problems? Not fewer people, huh? Some of you have just sworn it off, I think. Or it's sworn you off. Okay, let's see. Spiritual problems? You don't feel connected or whatever? Okay. All right. Well, this is your last chance. Just shout it out. If there's some other category.
Connecting to God.
Connecting to God. Okay.
Confidence.
Being positive?
Confidence.
Confidence. Okay. Not enough confidence or too much? Okay, you want to have enough money that you can help the world with it, okay. That's actually what a lot of people that make a lot of money do with it. That's what I do with a lot of the money I still have. Okay, well, I want to start off by telling you a little story that Jack Canfield told me. You guys know who Jack Canfield is, right? How many people have heard me speak before? God, I hope I've probably told this before or something. Jack was asked to speak at a charity event at somebody's home in the San Joaquin Valley. A beautiful, beautiful home. And the people that were there at this charity event were extremely wealthy people. Names you would recognize. And this... The guy who, Jack was there because they wanted him to convince these people that they should give money to help this organization that helped kids that were in trouble. And so the guy whose house it was got up first to introduce Jack. And in introducing him, he told a story about a little boy that had been in the school he'd gone to when he was young. And this little boy was kind of a fish out of water in a way. His father was an itinerant horse trainer, and they kind of lived out of this trailer that they pulled along beside this beat-up truck they had. And they moved around a lot because he would get hired by one rancher or something, and then that would end, and they'd go somewhere else. And so he moved a lot from school to school, and he was often in schools where the other kids had money, and they didn't have very much money. He often went to school wearing kind of scruffy clothes. Sometimes he even didn't have any socks with his shoes, or he didn't have a haircut. And so he felt very out of place. But one day at school, the teacher gave an assignment that got this little boy really, really engaged and excited. Because the teacher asked everyone to write a paper about a dream they had. Not the kind you have while you're sleeping, but a dream about your life. And he had one. And he'd been thinking about it for years, for a long time. And he'd already, worked it all out. All he had to do was pretty much put it down on paper. And his dream was that he wanted to be the biggest, most successful horse breeder and trainer in the world. And he knew exactly what the property that it was going to be on would look like, and what the main house that would be there would look like, and what all the outbuildings and corrals and all the places where the people that worked for him would sleep when they were sleeping there. And he had the whole thing worked out in his head, the whole thing. And so he went home and he wrote this paper, and he was really, really excited about it, and went back. He had diagrams on it and everything where he was, mapping out what it looked like and so on. And then he went back to school and handed it in. A few days passed, and the teacher then handed the papers back, and he was very excited to get his paper because he knew it was really good. And when he got his paper back, he looked at it, and at the top was this big red F and a note that said, "See me after class." So you can imagine how he felt. He went up to the teacher after class, said, "Why did I get an F? This was a good paper, I think. What's the deal?" And the teacher said, "Well, look, you live on a trailer, in a trailer on the back of a truck. You're not in the same income bracket as the rest of these kids. This is really way beyond anything that's realistic for you. Do you realize how much land in this valley costs? How would you ever do that? Do you realize how much breeding stock costs?" And the teacher went down all these, you know, things that he thought were very unrealistic about this goal. And finally he said, "Now look, if you will redo this paper with a more modest, more realistic goal, I'm just afraid that you're going to end up biting off more than you can chew. You're going to end up being disappointed. And so if you rewrite this with a more modest goal, then I'll consider changing your grade." So the little boy took the paper home to his dad and told him what happened. And said, the main thing he asked his dad was, "Well, what do you think I should do, Dad?" And his dad said, "Well, I can't really tell you what you should do. But I have a feeling that how you decide about this is going to have a huge effect on the rest of your life. So you had better really, really think about this." Now, I don't know if any of you have ever been in a situation like that, where you were faced with some sort of a crossroads decision. I mean, maybe this event is that crossroads decision for you. I don't know. But that's where this little boy was. Now, I remember a time when I was kind of in a place like that. I was 33 years old, and I'd quit my job. I was selling commercial real estate, and I quit my job 2 or 3 months before this because I was making zero money, and I thought, well, I can stay home and do stuff that's more fun and make zero money, so I decided to do that. So I had no job and no income, and then my wife told me she wanted a divorce, and she moved out, and she also found a way to take the last $3,000 that I had. So I had no job, no wife, no family, no money. And let me tell you, I was depressed, I was angry, I was really despondent. I had really, really hit bottom. And I don't know if you've been there, but it's not a great place to be. So I knew that I had to do something. So I started reading books about personal growth and how to have a happy life and how to be successful and how to make money and that sort of thing. And then I went to seminars, and I probably went to 20 or 25 different seminars. And I read 50 books or something. I was looking everywhere for a solution to my problem. And what happened was, and somebody else mentioned this, the more that I did this, the more confused I got. Because one person would say something like, you have to set goals and get really clear about the future. And another one would say, no, you really need to be really spontaneous. And another one would say, you need to start your own business. And another one would say, you need to mentor under somebody else. And then one would say, never go into debt. Debt is poison. And somebody else would say, the secret to this is OPM, other people's money. You know, getting other people to... And no matter what it was, there was somebody saying the exact opposite. of whatever somebody else had just said. And so I just became more and more confused. I don't know if you've ever felt that way, where you just felt so confused, you didn't know what to do, but that's what happened to me. Finally, I found someone who was helpful to me. And this guy was kind of, he was sort of part psychologist, part business advisor, part spiritual advisor. And he told me four things that he said were absolutely essential if you're going to have a successful life and a successful, let's say, to be successful in business and in life. The first thing he told me was that you have to take total responsibility for your life. If you're blaming other people for your situation, or you're blaming your circumstances, it isn't going to work. You have to take total responsibility for your life. And there's another way of taking total responsibility that I don't hear people talking about very much, and I'll mention this a little bit later. But that was the first thing he told me. The second thing he told me is you have to learn how to control your mind. Your mind really creates a huge part of your experience of life, and most people are not in control of very much of it at all. Even those who have been to zillions of seminars and read all the books and everything. And I'll also talk about that a little bit probably today. The third thing he told me is if what you're doing isn't working, try something else. Now, it was interesting about this guy because he charged actually a fairly large amount of money for helping people, and he was really good at it. And so when people would go to him, they would be evaluating him, whether they wanted, you know, whether they were willing to pay him and all this sort of thing. But actually, he was really picky about who he worked with, and he was actually evaluating them. And I took a friend of mine to him because he was having some problems, and I thought this guy could help. And he said, so what do you do? And the guy said, well, I'm kind of like a business slash life psychologist. And my friend said, well, you're going to make me do weird stuff like go out in the street in Las Vegas and ask people for money. Make me share my feelings with other people that I don't know very well. And, you know, sit across from someone and look in their eyes and stuff like that. And he got the impression that my friend was not willing to do whatever it takes to be successful in his life and in his business. And so he wouldn't work with him, which kind of reminds me, in a way, now that I think about it, of a Centerpoint person, a Holosync user, who I was talking to a couple of weeks ago, and he was telling me with almost ecstasy what had happened to him since he'd started using Holosync. And he was telling me about how his relationships were working better, how he felt more confident, his mind was clearer, he was taking action on things that before he had felt like he needed to, but he wasn't, and he had this whole list of things, you know, his anxiety was going away, emotional stuff seemed to be clearing up, and he was really, really going down a big long list of stuff that had changed for him. And then he said, but I do have one regret. And I said, well, what's the regret? I mean, after that list and everything, what's the regret? And he said, well, I wish I'd started doing this sooner because I had friends that were using this and they kept telling me how great it was. And then I didn't do anything anyway. And then finally, after 3 months of hearing about this, I got it and then I let it sit on my kitchen table without opening it for another 6 months. And then finally, I got started with it, and now that I see what it does, I feel like that 9 months was kind of wasted, and I wish I had got going sooner. Now, maybe you've been in that place before where you knew you had to get going on something, but you weren't getting going on it. No, probably nobody in this. Have you ever been on the freeway where you're going somewhere and you're really in a hurry, you've got to get there, and you're maybe driving a little bit over the speed limit because you're in a hurry? Probably none of you. And you're going along pretty fast, but then you come along a couple of cars who are right next to each other, blocking both the lanes, and they're going pretty slow, and you come up behind them, and you're going, okay, one of you, speed up. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. But they don't. They just keep going slow like that. Has that ever happened to you? And you just keep wondering, do they have their windows rolled down? Are they, like, talking to each other? Do these guys know each other or something? You know that feeling where you want to go, but something is holding you back? Well, I'm kind of hoping that what I share with you may be helpful in that regard. Now, I see a clock over there that says 2 minutes and 50 seconds. Is that the time until we're supposed to take a break? Is that the idea with that? Okay. So are you guys desperate for a break?
No.
Okay. So we'll go a little bit over, maybe 15 more minutes, and then we'll take our break, and then we'll come back, because I have a lot to share with you. Now, can you put this list back up there? At least on, does it, so you either put it on both screens, or you, is there a way to just put the list on one screen? And you don't need a picture of me up there, do you? I mean, here I am. There's nothing great to look at anyway. So, okay, so these are the things that that you mentioned, plus a few others. First of all, this isn't what I was going to talk about, but let me just mention one thing that I sort of hear in this group, and I hear this in a lot of groups. You know, we've gone through 20, 30, 40 years, maybe, of the upsurge of all this personal growth stuff, the upsurge of all this positive thinking stuff, the upsurge of all this law of attraction stuff and everything. And I think that it's given people the impression that there's something wrong with you if you aren't rich, if you aren't happy, if you aren't positive all the time, if you aren't loving and caring all the time, if you aren't, in an intimate relationship all the time where everything is great. And personally, I don't think that's very realistic. I don't think that's the way being a human being is. Now, I may not look like it, but I'm actually, one of my hats I wear is I'm a Zen monk. And my teacher is a guy named Genpo Roshi. How many people have heard of him? I've talked a lot about him to Centerpoint people. He's really an amazing guy. And one of the things that he's really gotten across to me that's from Zen is this idea, what they call in Zen, ordinary mind. And it's kind of, part of it is the basic premise, which I think is true, that all people have the capacity to be greedy sometimes, to be selfish sometimes, to be an asshole sometimes, to be out for themselves, to be negative, to feel bad, and so on and so on and so on. And my biggest impression of the whole New Age spirituality movement, or whatever you want to call it, is that they have disowned the negative side of things. In case you hadn't noticed this, this is a universe in which everything kind of lines up in polarities, where you can't have up without down. In fact, up is defined in terms of down. Down is defined in terms of up. Good is defined in terms of evil. Evil is defined in terms of good. Buying, selling, go together. Here and there go together. Having and not having go together. And so on and so on and so on. What I see going on out there is people trying to have everything in life be up and nothing be down. And then feeling a lot of anxiety when it doesn't work that way. Now, in psychology, they call that premise a double bind. A double bind is an insoluble problem. And human beings tend to set themselves up in double binds. In fact, we teach the basic double bind of life to people when they're very small, and all of you learned it. And I sort of tongue-in-cheek call this the game of black and white. When you're very small, you learn the names of everything, which gives you the illusion that there are all these separate things, when really they all exist kind of in relation to each other, but we don't have time to go into that aspect of philosophy. But we get this idea that there's a whole bunch of separate things and separate events in the world. This isn't what you thought you were going to learn today, is it? And then the next thing we're taught is that we need to divide these things into two piles, the white pile and the black pile. In the white pile goes all the stuff that is good and appropriate and desirable. And in the black pile goes all the things that are bad and negative and undesirable. And you each have your own white pile and your own black pile. And what's in your black pile is not the same as everybody else's because it is influenced by your culture and it's really influenced by your family. And it's, to some extent, it's influenced by different experiences you have. You know, if something happens and you feel some pain or distress over it, you probably put that in your black pile. I guess the black pile's over here. So anyway, once you've decided what goes in each pile, then you begin playing the game. And the game is to try to get more of the white pile and get rid of the stuff in the black pile, which is the same as wanting everything in the room to be up. Now, I'm not saying that you should not strive to be happier rather than sad, or that you shouldn't strive to be richer rather than poorer, or, you know, anything else, strive to be more intimate with people rather than less intimate. But there are times where you don't feel intimate with other people. There are times where you don't feel happy. There are times where you don't feel like you want to give, and so on. But most people that go to seminars like this have this idea that there's this ideal, which is their white pile, and they're supposed to be that way. But when you're not that way, then you feel crappy, and you think you've screwed up somehow. So the first thing I'd really like you to get is, like, give yourself a break. Let yourself be a human being. Human beings sometimes feel bad. Human beings sometimes don't feel like giving. They feel like, you know, I want something for me, and so on. I mean, I could go into this for hours in a lot of detail and talk about a lot of nuances that would cause you to go, aha, many times. But I just want to strongly make this point before we go into anything else, that I hear a lot in this group and in lots of other groups, it's not just you guys, of having this impossibly high ideal of everything's going to be white. everything's going to be white pile. And if it isn't, you feel really crappy about yourself. This is a double bind. You're setting yourself up to be disappointed about life. Ironically, when you realize that life has good and bad, positive and negative, and that you will be positive sometimes and negative sometimes and so on, not just the rest of the world, but you too, and you let it be okay that that's what being a human is partly about, then you kind of go, ah, because you don't have this impossible thing in front of you that you're trying to achieve that is unachievable. Because I'm telling you, I know lots of people that have beautiful or handsome or whatever partners, have more money than they'll ever spend, and do things that are very fulfilling, and they know what their purpose is and all that stuff, and they still feel shitty sometimes. So, you know, one of the things in the sort of New Age spirituality culture is that when people don't feel okay, they think, oh my God, what's wrong? I'm doing something wrong. I shouldn't feel this way. Whereas somebody who'd been trained in Zen would just say, okay, you know, the pendulum swings back and forth, and now I don't feel so good, and they let it be okay. Because there's really two kinds of suffering in the world. I hate to lay this one on you too, but there's a whole bunch of suffering in the world that you can't do anything about. And I'll briefly tell you what it is. First of all, there are 6.7 million people in this world. They aren't all on your side. They don't all go around every day trying to get you what you want. And sometimes what they're doing conflicts with what you want. And there's really nothing you're going to do about that. You can minimize it to some extent. There are some... I'm not trying to paint a really bleak picture, because there's plenty that you can do to make your life better. And I'll talk about that in a little bit. But there's a whole bunch of other people that have a different agenda than you do. And so sometimes, because of that, you're not going to get what you want. You may have experienced that a few times. Sometimes you're going to get what you don't want. In addition to the 6.7 million other people, there's also, you know, whatever the sun does and the weather and cosmic rays and earthquakes and you know, just other physical, non-human stuff that you don't have any control over, that, you know, is way beyond anybody's, you know, this whole idea that they're going to control CO2 or, you know, just laughable to me. I'll just go on record as saying they're not going to control it. And in fact, at just about the time that they begin to make a dent in it, they're going to find out that we don't have enough of it. And they're going to be thinking, oh, now how do we do more of it? And it's to me, it's ridiculous. But at any rate, so there's a whole bunch of stuff going on you don't have any control over. And so sometimes you get what you don't want, and sometimes you don't get what you do want, right? The other thing is that everything in this universe is impermanent. Everything comes into being, lasts for a while, passes away, no matter what it is. You know, your employee of the month, but next month you're not. You know, your kids are really cute when they're 3 years old, but, you know, they grow up. You're really strong and vital when you're in your 20s and 30s, and then you get older and you're not. And eventually everything falls apart, including you. That's the way it is. So there's a bunch of suffering built into being a human being that you're never going to escape from. There's no escape from this. Now, I know this probably sounds like negative thinking or something to some of you. I call it just being realistic. One of the things in Zen is, one of the important things in Zen is seeing things the way they really are. The game of black and white is about fighting against part of the way things really are. And it's an unwinnable game. So, okay, so there's a certain amount of suffering built into the world. Sometimes, you know, you don't feel good and all that stuff. What you do when you play this game of black and white is that to all that stuff that you really can't do much about, the one thing you can do about it is not blunder into it constantly. You know, I mean, if you keep, let's say, getting attracted to people who rip you off in some way or, you know, do something to you that causes suffering, and yet you keep gravitating to those people so that it happens again and again and again, which is what people tend to do, that you can do something about. In other words, there's all these sort of cause and effect bullets out there zooming around in the air, and some people just keep, you know, like the Secret Service guys of the president, they keep jumping in front of them, and many of you are doing that, I suspect, and I have done a lot of it myself and still do some of it. So you can kind of, you know, step out of the way if you're aware enough. So most of the suffering that you experience, I would say more than, most means more than half, is caused not by the circumstances out there that you can't do anything about, but your resistance to them. In other words, you're making part of the universe wrong or bad or undesirable or inappropriate and then trying to get rid of it. Now, I don't know if you've ever thought about this before. This is not what you hear in most seminars. But a fair amount of these problems that there was something implied in these, that there's some ideal on one side and something to be avoided on the other, and that you weren't yet, you know, getting your act together there somehow, and you were beating yourself up about it and in distress about it. In other words, you're resisting the fact that you just can't get rid of that black pile and you can't get enough of the white pile. Now, I'm not saying that you can't have more good in your life, more of what you want in your life, because you can. But you need to, like, become aware of yourself playing this game, because it's a very destructive game, and it causes you a lot of suffering, and it causes other people a lot of suffering. Now, one way to look at this game is that you take certain things in the world and you make them wrong. And let's just take the things about yourself that you think are wrong. Like, it's wrong to be angry. It's wrong to be selfish. It's wrong to put yourself first. Stuff like that. Let's just take stuff like that as an example. When you decide that those things are wrong, what you try to do is disown those parts of being a person. Everyone has the capacity. All the negative things you can think of, all the negative qualities you can think of, every human being at least has the capacity to be that way. Now, guess what makes you exhibit those terrible things that you don't think are okay? Trying to disown them, trying to repress them. I don't have time to go into this in a lot of detail, but I'll just tell you that if, for instance, you think being selfish is wrong, and so you try to disown being selfish. You know, your parents taught you and punished you or avoided you or gave you dirty looks or in some way gave you negative reinforcement whenever they perceived you being selfish. I mean, here you are, a two-year-old, and you want something, and, you know, they're trying to teach you not to be selfish. As if at two you have any idea what's going on. So anyway, you, I don't want to be selfish. In order to survive in this family, I need to get rid of that. And so you push that sort of down in the basement of your awareness. What happens, though, these are called shadows sometimes in Western psychology. What happens is that if you've disowned selfishness, you will be selfish in a very immature way. Everyone else will see it except for you because you've disowned it. And not only that, you will attract and be attracted to and see everywhere selfish people. Your world will be full of selfish people. to the degree that you have disowned this. And so you will be, selfishness will be a key part of your life, a key issue. Now, you might think right now about some of the key issues that you brought up to me. Because there's probably something you've disowned, some supposedly negative thing about being a person that you've disowned that's causing this to be an issue in your life. Now, what happens when you own these things? In other words, when you acknowledge that you have them, when you say, part of being human, and you stop fighting against it, that quality matures. And every negative thing, think of the lowest, meanest, crappiest thing you can think of about being a person, even that, when owned, matures into something that's beneficial to you and to other people. And in terms of selfishness, I mean, what is selfishness? You know, it's putting yourself first. Even talking about it, it sort of starts to mature. Because if someone is not selfish, they don't care about themselves. They have disowned the normal human tendency to think my needs are more important. I'm number one in my own life, you see. So what happens when you own selfishness is it matures into positive self-regard. And then into self-love. And once it really matures into self-love, what happens is that you feel kind of filled up in that way, and then you have plenty of love to give to other people. So by trying to disown something you think is negative, you exhibit it more and you attract it more, but by owning that, yes, I can be selfish, I can think that I'm most important, then it matures. And it always matures into something magnificent. So that's kind of my first message to all of you. After the break, we'll get into some nuts and bolts of this. And I'll talk to you a little bit about awareness, because I think that the secret to almost everything that you can do something about is awareness. So the main point I wanted to make, I didn't know I was going to want to make it until I started talking, but the main point I wanted to make this morning is stop playing this game of black and white where you decide that certain things are not okay and then you fight against them. Because all these things are normal things about being a person. And I'll just sort of give you a little homework assignment for the 2% of you who will actually do something with this, because that's what the statistics unfortunately show. What I would do is I would, when you go home, I would get a computer document up there, and I would make a list of everything in your white pile and everything in your black pile. And here's a clue to what goes in the black pile. If it triggers you, if it bugs you in other people, it's in your black pile. The very things that really trigger you in other people are the things that you've disowned in yourself, and that's why you get so triggered by these people. That's why you get attracted to them. And if people would only be honest with you, they would tell you that you are acting that way yourself, but you're doing it in a covert way, an immature way, a dysfunctional way, and it's causing suffering for you and probably for other people. So I would get really clear on what is in that white pile and what is in that black pile. And then start observing how you play this game. In fact, observing how you play it is way preferable to trying to stop playing it. That's another little key principle. Willpower doesn't really work. What works is awareness. So I'll tell you what I mean by that after we take a break. So